now, what is it? What are the English expressions in Star Trek? Energize, I think. So we are, you know, Dantinacus. We are, you know, we've talked a lot about the geometry of immersions. We've talked about the first and second the first and second variation of area. So that's when you have a family of surfaces, and when you compute the area of these surfaces, what you get is a function of one variable that you can try and understand. And one thing that you can try and understand is which surfaces have the property that whatever variation, geometric variation, will take, keeping the boundary fixed, the first derivative of the area along any such variation at the initial surface is always zero. So those are exactly minimal surfaces, surfaces of having vanishing mean curvature. So that's like the first derivative test for being a critical point that we are used to from high school calculus. And you know, something that we also know from high school calculus is we want to take the second derivative test, which, to be honest, is a little bit silly in high school calculus, as you know. So the point is, you want to check, or if you can show that the first derivative not only has a zero but actually changes sign, that is the property that you are really, really after. And that's usually a given in high school calculus. So second derivatives can take that. But with minimal surfaces, actually makes really good sense. So when you have a surface of which you know that it actually minimizes area amongst all compact perturbations, such as you do when you have an entire minimal graph, for example, then computing the second variation of area is not only a good idea, it's also very productive. So this is how we proved Bernstein's theorem in two dimensions. So when you have an entire minimal graph, a function satisfying the minimal surface equation from R to into R, then such a function must be linear. Its graph is to be a hyperplane. And how did we check that? We considered the stability inequality for stable minimal surfaces. So that is the inequality that says that when you take such a stable minimum, that when you take the graph of such a minimal, such a function satisfying the minimal surface equation, let's call it graph sigma, the integral over sigma of the Dirichlet, if you compute the Dirichlet energy of any completely supported function on such a surface sigma, then that is always greater or equal than the integral of the sum of squares of principal curvatures times that function of Dirichlet energy you are computing f squared. Mm-hmm. And then, we said, wouldn't it be nice if we could plug in f is equal to 1, right? That would correspond. So what does this f do geometrically? So it takes sigma and it lifts it, it creates a variation with initial normal velocity equal to f, right? So we can always do that. So f is equal to 1, right, would mean that you are so these are called unit normal perturbations. So when you push the surface off of itself at every point with the same speed in normal direction. So it turns out that's a terrific and extremely productive idea to do. But the problem with this test function f is equal to 1 is that it's not completely supported. So we can't just plug it in. If we could, right, then the Dirichlet energy of the constant function 1 is 0, right, and that would be greater or equal than the integral of sum of principal curvature squared, so all the principal curvatures have to be 0. So, but it turns out, effectively, we can get exactly that inequality because of this logarithmic cutoff trick. So the fact that you can actually mimic a harmonic function on your surface using that the area graph of such a minimal graph is quadratic, or at worst quadratic, and that's a basic fact about harmonic functions on the plane, that when you, let's say, take a disk of radius 1, that if you're computing infimum of Dirichlet energies of functions that are constantly equal to 1 on the disk, right, and compactly supported, the infimum over all these functions is, the Dirichlet energy over all these functions is, because so this logarithmic cutoff trick says, you know, if you go from 1 to 0 far out, say at r, radius capital R bigger than 1, that if you so if you connect 1 at radius 1 to 0 at radius R, the function that will give you the least Dirichlet energy is the radially symmetric harmonic function. So in dimension 2, that would be a function that, you know, it's a plus b log modulus of x. It's a function of this form, and so right. It turns out the functions of this form minimize Dirichlet energy, but you know, you don't need to know that. You can just compute the Dirichlet energy of such functions, and you will see that the Dirichlet energy is you know, you can compute it as a function of this outer radius r, and it just goes to zero as you take the radius to infinity. So it turns out that of course I don't have all my lecture notes. I have lots of lecture notes, but so let me continue now the discussion of harmonic functions that we've already started. So review of harmonic functions. So recall, so we are always taking n below equal to the 2. U is always an open subset of Rn, and h is a twice differentiable function. We say that H is harmonic if so that's the definition, the Laplacian of H is equal to 0, and the Laplacian of H is equal to 0. So it turns out that when you have a continuous, well, a C2 function that is harmonic, then it's actually a smooth function, right? We'll see that in today's lecture as well, a proof by Weyl's lemma today, just because we can. So there's a basic fact that we've already proven about harmonic function. It's extremely useful. So suppose I have a ball of radius rho centered in x whose closure is contained in u. Then it is true that when I'm computing the mean value of this harmonic function over this ball, then it's equal to the value of the function at that point. And similarly, I can take averages, so it's easy to see. If I'm computing the averages not over the volumes, but over the spheres. So that is called the mean value property. It's a great exam question because it's so important. Just saying. Property of harmonic functions. And okay. So there's a so we've proved it last time. There's a really neat consequence. This is a corollary. This so mean value property, maybe we should call this MVP, corollary of the mean value property, is that what is this corollary? Is the fact that h of x is leading like this. So infimum over, let's see, infimum over the sphere of radius x, so let's say h set, that is equal to the infimum over set. So for every continuous function, there's an inequality between these infima. How does it go? Which one's bigger in general? This one or the other?
We have the smaller set. So this one is bigger.
So this is less, in general, this is less than or equal than this? No,
the other way around.
So actually it's maybe stated in this way, in this order. But it actually turns out that for harmonic functions, this is less than or equal to h of x. And it's less than or equal to the supremum. And now the supremum over the small, again, sphere of radius rho.
I think that's too many Zs.
S wolf X rot. The ball with center X.
And also the sphere above.
Yes, and the sphere
in the first line.
To right. After the equal sign.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
Thank you. Right. And why I state? Because of the Mindara property. Right? Because, I mean, imagine this were any other way, this couldn't possibly be true. That's the proof. Yeah? So very useful. So harmonic functions on a ball, they take both the infimum and the supremum on the boundary. So that's actually there's something so that's the mean value property. So let's look at the higher order derivative estimates. So suppose that so that's another lemma. So I guess it's, you know, it's always under the same assumptions. Suppose that h is a... Let me take a little bit more space here. So suppose... Can somebody check the reach of the camera of this?
Last week one couldn't see this.
Is that the right? So we can see up to here?
Mm-hmm.
So this would be for scratch work. please help me remember. Let's see, the higher order derivative. So suppose h is a smooth function now, u harmonic, and suppose the e rho of x is contained in u. So then, it is true that if I look at I want to take a derivative of h of order k at x. I'm going to put an absolute value sign here. It doesn't really matter. Rho to the k is less than or equal to m times k to the power k times the supremum z in b rho x closure h of z. And again, I'm going to put the absolute value signs here, even though it's a good idea. No, it's a statement.
Okay.
So, so for every multi this alpha of length equal to k. Actually, I forgot one thing. I'm sorry. It's been on my mind. It's me. It is another. So these are the higher order derivative estimates, and those are, you know, you should recognize them. I mean, actually, this. So it's true, but you should recognize them from complex analysis. So, you know, we talked about these higher order derivative estimates that you actually get out of Cauchy's formula. And these are the analogs for harmonic functions. So let's see how this is proven. So, you know, it turns out it's almost enough to prove it for k is equal to 1. So let's start with k is equal to 1. So this case, when k is equal to 1, all these, you know, the partial derivatives that we can take are, you know, either partial 1, partial 2, you know, up to partial n. Right, so the statement is that rho times partial I of h at x is less than or equal n, right, times the supremum of the harmonic function over the radius. Right? So it's like, very much like this estimate, just that it turns out you can take, you know, you can also estimate the first partials by, and this is super unusual, right? I mean, for general functions, of course you don't take that you can estimate the size of the derivative by the size of the function, right? Let alone on a, and also, mind you, so maybe this is stated somehow, you know, this supremum here is of course the same as the supremum over the sphere by the mean value. So you can get derivative estimates of any order at a point, right? Solely in terms of the size of the function on the boundary, right? And you pay a little bit of radius and a little bit of m. So, so how does this go? So observe that if h is harmonic, then also all its first partials are harmonic. So when the first partials are harmonic, you can apply the mean value property to them. So you have so something that we see is that so this is mean value property. Sorry, we see that a partial one of h, a partial I of h. So this is less than or equal, I'm going to put absolute value signs here just for sure, is less than or equal the mean value of partial I over the bottom. Mm-hmm. So, that's the mean value property. So now this is equal to, so you know, let's get rid of this this average, or rather let's get it out. So this is omega n rho to the n, that's the volume of this ball, right, times the e, this is my copy, partial ih, and see this is this is the divergence theorem. Because what this is the gradient of h dotted with, this is the divergence of the vector field that has, you know, all zeros in all components except for the I form at h. Yeah. So this is equal to one over omega m rho to the m divergence theorem. So it's an integral over the boundary of the sphere of radius rho times. H times so it's the unit normal times yi, right? So it's the outer Poynting unit normal, the ice component of it. Ice component of it.
Yes. First, just a reminder that this is the scratch board. And And also just maybe I missed something, but here in the first inequality, right? So partial I h is a harmonic function, right?
I'm sorry.
So this is yeah.
So I'm sorry, it was a mistake to start with. So, but you see, it's splendid. So let me copy this from the switchboard. So this is 1 over omega n rho to the n. The integral of s rho x of h mu I. Okay, and this is less than or equal. Okay, so this implies that now I'm taking absolute values, partial I of h and x is less than or equal, so absolute values here, and I'm estimating the integral over the sphere absolutely, so by the area of the sphere times the supremum of the of the integrand, so this is size 1. So this is less than or equal 1 over rho to the m. So the sphere, the area of the sphere, actually let's clarify this, the area less than or equal, so this is omega m rho to the m. So the area of the sphere is m times omega m times rho to the m. Times the supremum of h z, where z is in s rho of s. And that's exactly the inequality. So this finishes the case where k is equal to 1.
So I'd give an answer, but I think for logic to work, you have to put an equal sign there at the bottom of the first line, not on the second.
Agreed. It's actually no logic. Well, we don't have to make it about we don't have to make it about logic. We can just say to correct it. Yeah. Okay. So really need proof, right? What goes into it, the mean value property, the fact that you know, that's a commutator technically, right? The fact that a harmonic function has harmonic derivatives. Yeah. So that's it. So so now the question is how you continue. Yes, exactly. You iterate, and I'm not going to, so I'm leaving this to you as an exercise, right? This is you know, so the case where k is bigger or equal than 1, you apply, you iterate with radii rho is equal to with radii rho over n. Think about what that means, k times.
Rho
over k.
We have a rho probably.
Yeah.
I.
Okay. So there's an important consequence of this. So every time, so this means for every harmonic function, you get bounds on every derivative of the function in terms of the initial oscillation. Yeah? And now you have a you know, Azeda Ascoli or whatever you want to call it. So the fact that when you have does this have a name? So what I want to say is that when you have a family of harmonic functions with bounds on the oscillation on every compact subset of the domain, there is a subsequence that converges
with all the relatives. Let me just spell it out.
Also, this is what the Sazeda Ascoli say, when you have an equicontinuous family of functions, there's a convergent subsequence.
Yeah,
I think that's what it means. Yeah.
That's
definitely what equicontinuous and equibounded,
yes,
to shape.
Yes.
come on.
What
is the point of infinity for functions? The function at infinity? It's almost like the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. You know?
I think what you said is in complex analysis called Montel's theorem. But so maybe
in
complex analysis, it's Montel's theorem, what you say, no?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I bet you in Italy it's somebody else. But enough tangent on me. So that gets really good input. So let me just take this off. Okay, these are the drops of light. So next time I'll clean the backboard properly again. This is not working for me. So until this is dried up, let me so that is the corollary I can now. Right on here. Corollary. Same assumptions as before, so the ball of radius rho centered at x is, its closure is contained in u. So there's a slightly larger ball that is still contained in u. So suppose that h i is equal 1 to infinity r, so this is a subsequence of smooth functions in u. With such that the supremum supremum and supremum h is rho of x is less than infinity. So this is the more functions. So the thing is, there is a subsequence. Um, in the harmonic. In the harmonic function H, it is smooth in B from X, such that partial I prime minus partial converges to such that for every 0 less than sigma less than rho and Marti index. Alpha, we have the partial alpha of H. Partial alpha H can be over the partial alpha H uniform. So on every smaller set you have. So this is what is called smooth convergence, except for the passing to smaller sets. You can say smooth convergence on smaller sets. And the proof is, so I guess, you know, first you start by identifying such a function H, right? I leave the proof to you as an exercise. It's essentially a Zieler-Ascoli, right? And derivative estimate. There's another thing that goes into this, it's some real analysis factor when the derivatives converge, then the functions converge. So, But it's certainly no more than this. Okay, so this is very useful. So now I'd like to prove the parent of all regularity theory. What is the parent of? The parent of all interior regularity theorems in partial differential equations. Who's the parent? It's actually, maybe it's more Rea-Haas lemma in complex analysis. You know, the fact that a continuous function is holomorphic if it integrates to zero on all rectangles, for example, rectangular paths. That might be the parent of all. I don't know, but it's called Weyl's lemma. Okay. So this is our next goal in this class is to prove Weyl's lemma. And I need a little bit of let me state Weyl's lemma first, and then you know, there's a little bit of preparation we need for the proof, but it's good real analysis, so I'd like to go over it. So Weyl's lemma says the following. So suppose you have a function in L1 log of U such that the integral of h times the Laplacian of every function f that's continuous, smooth and completely supported on u. So when you have a smooth and completely supported function on u, its Laplacian would be smooth and completely supported. You can integrate it against an L1 log function. Yeah? And if it's always equal to zero, let me start the other way. Suppose H were a smooth harmonic function or a C2 function that is harmonic, right? Then this always holds. And why is that? Because you can integrate by parts twice, right? You can take the Laplacian, so the Laplacian is, right, it's a divergence of a gradient, right? So you can,
is this integration of arts here all over I mean? Okay, so so you can, you know, if this is smooth and if this is smooth and this is completely supported, right? And if this is harmonic, then that holds, that equality holds. Because you can you can integrate by parts twice, there are no boundary terms where the Lagrangian meets the H. If H is harmonic, that's zero. Yeah. And why is Hermann says the converse is also true. So if this always holds, then H has a smooth representative, right? As a measurable function, a smooth representative that is harmonic. So that's fine, Slema. Actually, the proof is really, this would be so interesting. So if I had a little more time, I think I would be reading all. So Weil's mathematical writing is amazing. But I've actually never taken the time to look at his original proof of this result. I suspect, you know, that the proof I'm going to show with you is certainly a standard proof, the one that you find in most textbooks. I find it hard to think of another proof, to be honest. So maybe this was his proof to start with, but anyway, I'll show it to you. Who has seen a proof of Weil's lemma in a class? Which class, Tarek?
Actually, advanced complex analysis.
With Gerhard?
No, with Rainer, with Armin Rainer.
Yeah. And not just for harmonic functions, for holomorphic.
No, for harmonic, because we use a lot of subharmonic functions.
So let's look at the proof. So we need a little bit of preparation. So have you seen mollifiers? How to mollify? Janine, have you? So I'll review it, but it's just so if you have questions about mollification, this, if you've never seen it before, this will be. This might be too quick, but I'm happy to explain afterwards if questions remain. So suppose eta is a smooth function on R, non-negative, with support of eta contained in the ball of radius 1. So omega, which is and suppose that and which integrates to 1 and there's another end, and I'm asking you to think about where this end is used, right? And 1 that is even such that eta of x is equal to eta minus x. So it's easy to come up with such functions, right? You would take a radial function that is maybe you might take a function, right, that is radially equal to 1 and then decays to 0. So if this is the profile of the function g, then you might consider eta of the form eta of x is equal to g of the modulus of x corrected by a constant c such that it integrates to 1. So you take any one of these functions and then you know. Then you rescale, so then it becomes mean. So if you, from such functions, you can
So it turns out I have a namesake. Her name is Eva Eichmeier, and she's also, she's very unusual. And she's my friend, and so we are not related, we believe. But we are friends because we have the same last name. That, you know, if you look it up in the telephone book, there are, you know, Eichmeier spelled correctly, a very few of us. So, it turns out we don't seem to open it. And Eva Eichmeier, she's a teacher at BBRD 15 on Henriette in Paz, which is a school. School at it, a gymnasium. And so she's a teacher of French, German, and Deutsch. It's German is a foreign language, and is a second language. And she also has a PhD in French and German literature. So she's a really interesting exceptionalist, but just so I'm kind of proud of our lives. But we're not related. I guess that's what that was my intermission. So with what can you do with such a function? You can rescale it further. So for epsilon bigger than zero, you can define functions eta epsilon. Such that eta epsilon of x is equal to eta x divided by epsilon epsilon to the minus a. So bear with me. If I know the support of eta is in a ball of radius 1, what can you tell me about the support of eta epsilon?
Radius epsilon.
Okay, so the support of eta epsilon is in a ball of radius epsilon, etc. And what can you tell me about the integral of eta epsilon?
It's 1.
So what you're doing is you're rescaling the profile of the function only in the domain. You're rescaling homothetically. So when you take any shape, right, and you axially, if you want, scale it, right, then its integral changes, you know, the volume of the shape between blah 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 by the appropriate vector, right? So, and if you shrink from 1 to epsilon, and if you want to keep the volume equal to 1, you should stretch backward by a large number, right? Epsilon to the minus n, turns out. So this is equal to 1. And of course, it's still the so now, these are called symmetric mollifiers, also sometimes called Friedrich mollifiers.
This is an S.
Friedrichs. Thank you for teaching me. Thank you. No, this is okay. People think I'm very stubborn. It's maybe true, but actually I'm a very stubborn learner.
I just know because Gerhard corrected me years ago in the exam. Because I also said Friedrich.
Memorable exams. I'm sorry. Thank you. Friedrichs modifier. So suppose now that you have a function f that is a locally integrable function u, then you can define f. Oh, I'm sorry. It means the locally integrable on Rn. And we can define the function f epsilon. So this
first define it and then we talk about what type of function it is.
but it's defined as the integral of f, let's say f y eta epsilon of x minus 1. I mean, it's true. It might not have been the best way to get it started. So let me rewrite this expression. And I'm going to fill it in. I'm going to use my blackboard liberty. So this should be the same as f. Give me a moment. X minus epsilon y eta. Okay, so let me move over to the scratchboard. So I also claim this is correct. Let's see. No, I'm sorry. This is all good. No, okay. So I'm going to take this back. Okay. So when I have the integral of f of y eta x minus y. So let's put the epsilon there. So let us first see just what we get by a simple change of verb. So first of all, it's well defined, right? Because this is defined everywhere, it's locally integrable. The support, right, for every x, the support of this lies in the ball of radius epsilon centered at x. Yeah? So I can certainly perform this integral, I'll get a number. Yeah? Good. So point out, there's no problem. So now let's just see what we get by a simple change of variables formula just by the translation. Yeah? So when, you know, this is an integral over y. So let's say I want an integral, and I want to replace my integration variable in this way. So this would mean that z minus x is equal to y. Yeah. So this means that the volume element is the same. It's just the translation. Yeah. So this is equal to the integral with respect to z, f of z minus x, eta epsilon z.
X minus z is y.
Yes, okay, let me. So x minus y is z. So I want to know what y is. So it's x minus z, thank you. X minus z, okay. So,
now that's big.
Just a moment.
Okay.
Yeah? But now this is a symmetric modifier. So this is it again. And now, right, I can do another change of variable. If you remember how this is defined. So this is defined by the integral z. So let me just spell it out. Z minus x epsilon minus m eta z divided by epsilon. Yeah. So now I'm going to change my integration variable back to y. You know, this is fun. It's like high school integration. So, you know, the volume element with respect to z is epsilon to the n times the volume element with respect to y. So this is the same as the y integral of f. So now help me with this. Z becomes replaced by epsilon times y minus x, eta times eta of y.
Are you sure that this is what you want?
It's what I did. No. Is this correct?
No, it's not.
Yes.
Oh.
But don't you want them the other way around? I mean, x and y.
Okay.
I think you want commutativity of the convolution and scaling, right? So.
Okay, so let me save my grace. So everything I've written down is, I believe, correct. Okay, so you can stay on the switchboard, even if it's not very useful. This is the definition. I'm going to take this as the definition. I'm going to observe that this function here is a smooth function. Why is it a smooth function? Right? Because it's a parameter integral and it depends smoothly on the parameter x. Right? So this is so f epsilon is a smooth So now, so I make a few claims now. Claim number one: if x is an object point. Remind you what it is in a moment. Then f epsilon of x converges to f of x. If epsilon tends to zero, these are the pointwise values. So what does it mean to be a big point? It means that you are the value of that, you know, almost every, you can change it almost everywhere and it'll stay the same L1 function remote out. So being at a big point means you fix one version, you know, in particular measurable of your function f. And then being at a big point means that the integral of brx the limit as r tends to 0. Maybe let me say rho, because we've used rho before, of b rho x of f, say, so this is a definite y rho in b rho x, f of y minus f of x, this is rho. So now this entails that f of x, the value of the function, the value of the function at x is equal to the limit as rho tends to zero of the averages of that function at the point x. This is the radii of the most. Yeah. So this is also very easy to show if you write this down correctly. So think about it. It's almost the definition. So there's another, so this, I leave it to you as an exercise to check your finding evidence, for example, explain it at Billy Hook-Palomin's evidence. It's very basic, you know, but it's essentially real analysis. So you should know this is true, right, but I won't make you prove it in an exam, for example. It would be this I would not, I have to be careful, so this I wouldn't ask you for the proof, if I don't show, unless I show you in person. So suppose that 1 is less than or equal to p is less than infinity, and suppose that f is an LP function, Rn, then it turns out that f epsilon converges to f in LP this is true, so there is a cliche. Why is this true? So there is a cliche of this, why this is true. Which cliche am I after? So there's a reason, and the reason is a general line pattern. In LP for 1 less than equal P less than infinity, not for infinity, what is continuous? Translation. So notice if f is a continuous function, then it's, you know, every point is a repetitive point. And in fact, you can by uniform continuity also spin this argument. So a third property is that if f is a continuous function, so this is an easy property in the case any compact subset of Rn, then f epsilon to f uniform so this is a set silent test. So this is again, this is an easy property using uniform continuity and compact sets of continuous. So now, let me show you the proof of bias lemma. Ah, there's one last thing. So this is also, this is extremely useful. If you have two functions, f and g in L1 locally integrable, and one is continuous. One integrable, one in L1 of Rn. This is a bit of a strange way of stating, it's not optimal. But one thing that is true is that when you are modifying, so these are called the modified functions. If modified, it's a bit of a strange word because you don't, it's not, so it means to smoothen, modify. I don't actually know where the term comes from originally. It's some figure, I believe it comes, it's a Nordic term.
I think it's Latin.
Yeah, I also think Latin.
Yes.
Because mollusks are mollusks. Are like snails and stuff, right?
Yeah,
they are soft mollusks.
Also, mollusk, as opposed to.
Okay, I'm sorry. Let's work on my classical and Euclid. Yeah, I didn't study that, but I'm interested in this. Okay. But it's not a common word to use outside of a mathematical context in English. That's what I wanted to say. So,
Liam, would you agree?
Yeah. Thank you. So these modifications of f, which are smooth, when I integrate against another function, then this is the same. This is the same as f g1. And if you think about it, this is Fubini's theorem. Maybe actually you have to be a little bit careful. Think about this. There's maybe a slight subtlety here, is to the. But it is the bottom line. It's Fubini's. It's a version of Fubini's theorem. Okay. So this is also useful. And another thing that is useful is that if f is smooth. Or is ck, on Rn, partials of f and modify them, then it's the same as taking the partials of the modifications. So this commutes. So again, you know, when you go into the definition, it's a question of it's integration by parts. It's the symmetry, and it's maybe something else, but this doesn't matter. This is mostly right. So now I'd like to see the proof of Weyl's lemma. This is on record. So there's a book I actually quite liked as a student, but now I really don't like it anymore, so I'm not going to recommend it to you on discourage you from reading it while I'm record. So a book that I think explains this very neatly is Evans' book, Evans' PD book. So maybe let's leave the properties. Let's do the proof of Weyl's lemma. We call him Weyl's lemma first. So, the proof of Weyl's lemma. So, it's convenient let u epsilon to be, so, you know, this is always open, so the set of all points x and u such that not only x, but also the ball of radius epsilon set that x is contained, is fully contained in u. Mm-hmm. So this is an open subset of u, and all the points in u epsilon have distance, at least epsilon, from the boundary. Yes. Competing thoughts. Suppose I have a function f which is completely a smooth function on Rn with support, with the support of f in u epsilon. So then the support, so you can think about this, the support of the modifications, the modification of f with parameter epsilon, that's contained in u. So let me see. So this is, I wanted to be everything completely completed. It's helpful. And it's true. So then we know that zero is equal to so this is the assumption by lemma h of this is true. Right? Because the assumption is this is true for every f epsilon compactor supported in U, so in particular for these modifications. The special functions. So now this this Laplacian of f epsilon, right? That's the same as the Laplacian of f, which is a smooth function modified. This is this last property that we discussed, that I discussed number 5. And now, by the fourth property, right, I can throw the modification over to h. Well, I guess. So this, the Laplacian of f, the support of the Laplacian of f is all is compact in U. Right? The support is the support of this function is compact in U. So I can integrate by parts here without boundary terms. And, you know, the Laplacian, that's two integration by parts, you know, and the differential operator that takes again. So this is the Laplacian of h epsilon, right? H epsilon, that's a modification of h is smooth. I can compute its Laplacian times f. What?
Oh, just one minute.
Let me finish my line of proof and then we'll fix it together. So see, this is true for every function f that's completely supported in U epsilon. So this means that Laplacian of h epsilon vanishes on U epsilon identically. But you can't integrate to zero against every function unless you are zero yourself. So this implies that the Laplacian of h epsilon is equal to zero on u epsilon. So h epsilon is a harmonic function on u epsilon. So this means I have derivative estimates on h epsilon. Right? So I can estimate also the derivatives of h epsilon on every set, you know, that's maybe on u 2 epsilon, right? I can estimate all the derivatives of h epsilon, you know, and for every order of derivative uniformly. So I'm wondering if there's anything more to say. So this means by the derivative estimates for harmonic functions that we've already proven that you know, these functions h epsilon, there's a derivative estimate on them that's independent of epsilon. Think about this. So these h epsilons are modifications of h, right? Their L1 norms locally are all bounded by 2 times the L1 norm of h. So these are harmonic functions whose L1 norms on U epsilon are, you know, on any compact subset of U, are uniformly bounded. And then you have all these derivative estimates. So these functions H epsilon, they are also an equicontinuous family of functions with a continuous parameter now. So,
remind me about the properties of H were in the assumptions of the theorem?
In one look.
Then why exactly is the first step true? So 0 is equal to the integral of H.
Oh, oh, I'm sorry. That was the other assumption.
Ah, okay. Nice. That's wrong. <really cool.
laughs> So the other assumption is called the weakly harmonic. What's called weakly harmonic. So, so this means you know, the feminine H epsilon for epsilon bigger than 0 is all derivatives uniformly bounded. So this converges on the one hand, converges to H almost everywhere, at almost every point. This is a property of you know, because almost every point is at a big point. And at the same time, it's so almost every point on the one hand, and smoothly on compact subsets. Smoothly on compact. It converges to a smooth function, which must then be equal to the original function h almost everywhere. So h is h plus h is a smooth representation. This is a really great piece of mathematics. Again, remember this is the parent of all interior regularity theory. And this property, not one that H is L von Bloch, but the other, that H integrates to zero against the Laplacian of every complicated supernormal function, that's called weakly harmonic, to be weakly harmonic. So every weakly harmonic function is secretly strongly harmonic. And in particular, every C2 harmonic function is a smooth harmonic function. So I would like to finish with the Dirichlet problem. And I'm going to state it only from B1 to R given by X goes to, so it's a bit of a funny way of writing it, 1 minus modulus of X squared, 1 minus the modulus of X squared divided by x minus the modulus of y squared. Is harmonic. So notice these functions. Let's about this bit for a moment. Let's just pretend y is equal to 0. Then, oh, I'm sorry. The power is of course wrong. Actually, I'm confused by myself. And just to do it. Yeah, so I just made this claim. There's a question I have myself, but let's just pretend this is all true. So this is a harmonic function. This is a computation that you can do, that this is a harmonic function. And it integrates. It integrates to m omega m on this field of radius. You can integrate over the boundary. It's sinking on the boundary, but you know it's a it's a non-negative function, so there's no issue with integrating it, and I claim what it integrates to is fixed. Mm-hmm. So then I claim that the function h in B1 given by x, so h of x is equal to, so this is now the average over s1, so this is a y integral of v of y times this function 1 minus x squared divided by minus 1 to the n. So this function is harmonic in x. Because it's actually an average of harmonic functions. So for every, I mean, the way to think of it is that for every y, this is a harmonic function. Yeah. And you know, by computing this weighted average with respect to v, you get an average of harmonic function. So that is, so it's just so but you know the reason it's how to check that it is harmonic is just by putting you know to think of it as a parameter.
So what's v?
So v is just a continuous function, but it could actually be a so let v be an L1 function of the sphere of radius 1. And so now it turns out is harmonic. So no. So this node actually contains something for you to check. if V is actually a continuous expansion on S1, then the function problem. So this is a theorem. This is the solution of the Dirichlet problem. That if V is a continuous function. Sphere of radius 1. Let's say the sphere of radius rho centered at x, there is a unique function h that is continuous, that is smooth of the interior continuous up to the boundary, such that Laplacian of h is equal to 0. This is, smooth up to and including the boundary, so it's the same, and such that h is equal to v. I've just handed you the function. I told you how to find this function. I mean, there are a few things that you need to verify. The important thing is to know that it's true. You can work with it as a black box. Of course, it's even better when you can follow the proof. There's at least one thing, that's maybe not quite clear, is that is the uniqueness. But imagine you have two such functions, h1 and h2, then the difference would be harmonic and vanish on the boundary. And by the maximum principle, the function would have to be 0. Very proud of my students. So thank you for bearing with me. So next week we'll have a quick start. Somehow turn this into a geometric picture. There's still something I need to tell you about the Dirichlet energy of the harmonic function. So we have everything we need now to discuss the solution of the Darkin-Sharp problem. Can somebody release me from the recording, please?